right, so what's the band's name and how'd you guys come up with it and what does it stand for?
Man, we are Concrete Dream. We came up with this name. It's funny how like it's really a movement, and at the same time it's a lifestyle, and at the same time it's like the epitome of what all four of us have been trying to do our whole lives, was, you know, just live our dream doing this music shit, you know, whether it was in, you know, one band or another band or however, you know, the case may be. But it's really open for interpretation, and we really want people to take it however they feel. But at the end of the day, it's about never being too old to live your dreams and really see shit through. That's what makes it concrete. Being from New Jersey, being from, you know, Hudson County and all that shit, we made out of concrete. So it kind of just went with each other.
How'd you guys all meet?
Well, the funny story, we met, like, we've known each other forever. I mean, everybody here, we've all been in the same scene. You know, I've known Juan for years. We were in Heroes of the Enemy together.
We go way back to the Equip days.
We go all the way back to Equip Studios. On top of that, we were able to meet Mena through the scene with his band. And Mena coming through a real progressive part of the scene and metal, playing guitar. And he finally was able to make it over to Juan. Juan was able to play drums for him in one of his old bands. And then I was starting this hip-hop project with White Henny. Recruited Juan, needed a bass player. Mena came aboard. White Henny broke up. Boom. We're here. Concrete Dream.
And then I came out of nowhere.
And then Mena found JFK. Mena found JFK and really linked with him. And, you know, they actually... I'm going to pass the mic to Mena because it was a real interesting story how he snuck JFK into the band.
The cover of Darkness.
Customs. I played with JFK with his band called The Great Airport Mystery, and you know, they had a really nice progressive melody and very progressive kind of style. So when I heard he was a free agent, I was like, yo, I gotta scoop up this kid, because this kid just brings it every time in the stage. So I remember taking him with me to work on a song that I wrote like a while back. And
yeah, I just went with you on a whim.
What's up?
I just went with you on a whim.
Yeah, you just went with me. You know, you're just like, yo, I'm about it. And then ultimately we created one thing, and the rest is history.
Linkin Park or Slipknot?
Slipknot.
Slipknot.
All right, modern me is saying Slipknot, but in my heart, the child in there is Linkin Park.
Linkin Park all day.
Have you guys ever taken the Buckout Road, and what is it like?
You know, Buckout Road is crazy. So the story, you know, the story came from our manager and him growing up in the upstate New York area. Buckout Road is actually this crazy haunted road where a bunch of albinos live into the forest. And then if you go onto the road and you honk your horn, they actually come out and they fucking attack your car. It's actually fucking insane. And you can go on YouTube, there's mad shit on it. We've had people at shows come up and describe their version of Buckout Road. But it's basically just like a haunted road, like a fucked up road. So I've never personally been on it, but all the research and stories I've done about it, and now we got the movie coming out, the Buckout Road movie with Danny Glover and all these people. And you know, it's like this folklore is like really emerging now. It's like a phenomenon of this horror road. I thought it was funny to write, you know, a song. What if I went on an L ride with a girl on this road? Or what if this, you know, fucking dysfunctional couple goes on this L ride just to smoke and, you know, for an adventure, like a weird New Jersey type thing. And it just all goes wrong. It goes bad shit wrong, because 90% of the time shit goes wrong. And, you know, it's just a journey, man. It's a fun story. It's a horror story. People love horror. You know, we love the thrill as humans. We love to be thrilled and we love to be excited. So I feel like talking about things people don't want to talk about, and normally in music, is one of our goals as well.
Now we're stuck. We have to go up there.
Yeah.
Honk three times to see what happens.
Yeah, we're definitely planning on going up there. I'm actually looking at property up there right now, currently.
I'm trying to buy that barn that the kid died in.
Yeah, he's trying to buy the barn that the kid died in.
Your guitar play through there?
Yeah.
One of the houses?
Middle of the night.
Middle of the night?
Yeah.
Make sure the albinos are there.
There's going to be a lot of albinos.
How was it performing with POD?
Man, it was like, seriously, just get it to be able to play two shows with them and Nonpoint at the same time was like fucking intense. Like me growing up listening to Sonny and listening to POD, and like, you know, just, you know, they were speaking to me, man. Like, seriously, like their music fucking spoke to me in a way, like, you know, and let me know that I wasn't going crazy being a kid in the hood and from the project listening to metal, you know, because they were too. And it was just an honor. Like, you know, during our sound check, we got to meet Sonny. Sonny came up to us both times, but the first time he did, I was like all choked up. I didn't even know how to act. I was about to damn near cry in front of homie. You know, to me, you know, he's a real inspiration, just being that he's still in the game doing the shit, you know, 20 years in, still making money, still spreading the same message, man. It's some powerful shit. And then to get to meet Nonpoint at the same time, to me, was just fucking epic. Let alone to set the stage off, you know.
Like, meet Sonny, and meet a guy who's still so humble. And
oh, man, how humble.
So appreciative and so...
I mean, he's just... He talks to everybody, man. I mean, dude, he's out there rocking our shirts right now. God bless him, you know what I mean? It's amazing, you know what I'm saying? Like, the whole team. And it was just a complete honor. And we might actually go back on the road with them, man. The whole, God willing, man. It's going to be dope, man. Word up.
7-string or 6-string guitar?
7-string, baby.
Yeah, it's all 7. They tried to make me go 6 for a minute, but I'm going back to it.
We're a fan of that heavy.
Who are you guys planning on going on tour with next? Like a big act.
Well, like, obviously we all strive. Like, you know, I'm pretty sure everybody here in the band wants to go on tour with, you know, one of their main idols. So, like, I'm looking at right now, we're looking at Limp Bizkit. We're looking, obviously, looking at POD, like we said before. We might go on tour with Body Count. That'd be badass.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of different options for us right now. We're just waiting with the label to pick the right tour to bid on. And it all has to make sense. You know, the timing, the routing. You know, it's we got one shot to go on this tour. So, we kind of want to do it right. And there's so many different people we could open up for. So, it's really on, like, just the timing, really. That's what it really comes down to. But we definitely going to go on tour this winter. It's going to happen. We are going to see this country and this world. We're coming at you, world. We're coming to you.
Coming for you.
All right? We're coming to every state, every country. Russia, Brazil, Australia. We coming out there. Arkansas, Arizona, Florida, motherfucking Greenland, motherfucking Finland. We coming out there.
Do heartache songs sell more than love songs?
You know, that's a really good question. And I think it really goes on the vibe of, like, what month you're in. Or where you are in time, really, you know, and what's going on. And being that, you know, the world is so damaged right now, I feel like heartache songs, everybody really relates to. But at the end of the day, people still like hearing a good love song, you know, and people want to have hope for love, you know, because, you know, we should never lose hope and hope. You know what I mean? Like, there should always be, like, you know, a chance to, like, love someone or love another, or, you know, most importantly, love yourself. You know what I mean? So I try to make songs about, you know, self-love and positivity, but I also try to speak about the reality and the duality of something, because, you know, but, you know, you can't have good without bad. You know what I mean? And no matter what will happen, nothing is perfect. So that's a real hard question for me, but I would have to say definitely heartache songs.
Yeah, it's inevitable. Everyone kind of faces heartache in some way. And so it's just, you have a stronger attachment to it. And, you know, people connect to that more.
That's facts. It's not everybody gets the opportunity to really, you know, fall in love. So ain't nobody, you know, really trying to hear that shit. Like, oh, man, you motherfuckers playing a love song. I ain't love, man. Fuck that. You know, there's some people out there that are really about fuck love. You know what I'm saying? That, you know, that ain't getting no love. And, you know, I feel bad for those people. You know what I'm saying? But in the words of John Lennon, all you need is love. So, yeah. You know,
so do you write all the songs, or do you guys collaborate on songwriting?
Well, it depends on what you mean. I feel like the band is genuinely producing all the songs together. You know, I write the lyrics, and you know, the guys definitely, you know, help me out on, you know, what sounds cooler, what sounds hotter. You know, there's definitely shit gets rewritten, and there's so many different versions of shit that I'll be pumping out. But for the most part, and we have a fair system of writing songs. You know, Mena comes with ideas. We all work on them. JFK comes with ideas. We all work on them. I come with ideas. You know, there's sometimes I'll be throwing riff ideas at them.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're in on the musical process.
Yeah, you're right. We all...
You're on the lyrics.
I feel like, and you know, like Juan came up with the idea for Lip Kit. You know what I'm saying? And Mena wrote, you know, damn near our first 3 songs. So it's like, we all have, like, you know, a job. I feel like that's why we're such a good band, is that we all really link with each other and really feed off each other's energy. And I feel like that's what's dope about us. And now we're going into a more heavier direction for the second record. So, you know, the music is going to change and the sound is going to change. But I feel like it didn't change, it evolved. And we evolved as writers, getting to work with Ricky and my manager, and you know, getting to work with so many other producers, and just, you know, life has evolved us. I mean, this guy has become a monster musician. This guy's a monster musician. This guy's a monster musician.
Appreciate it.
You know what I'm saying? These guys, you know, and I feel like I've only became better as a lyricist and a wordsmith. That, you know, we're gonna, you know, this next record, you know, we're gonna call it Wolfpack. The name of the record is gonna be called Wolfpack, and it's gonna be brutal. And we're gonna show people, you know, real raw emotion and real unity. This record's about unity and emotion, because, you know, we are, like, I call us a wolf. We're Concrete Dream, but, you know, the crew, we call ourselves a Wolfpack, because, you know, you attack one, you attack all. If one is hurting, one is hurting. If I'm sad, he's sad. You know what I'm saying? We really back each other up emotionally and mentally and, you know, spiritually in life. And I feel like that's important. So, like, that's what this record, next record, is going to be about. And it's going to be heavy.
What's the most expensive piece of equipment you've purchased as far as, like, your line of duty?
For me, I've never really purchased anything that expensive more than my laptop that I write all the songs on. I'm very dependent on my laptop, so I would say I capped out at like $3,000 so far, but I am buying my digital rack and a bunch of cool shit for me, so I'm probably gonna be in like the $8,000 range, but right now I would say I'm $3,000 in with my laptop.
You catch up to us.
Yeah. Definitely the Kemper. John and I use the Kemper, so yeah, please. All right, give us another one. Yeah, it's definitely over 2 G's. The bass that I have is the NG2 Dingwall. You know, props to Nolly for making such a beast as bass. And, oh yeah, and I got the BTB Khaleesi Ibanez. And that shit rocks too. So, yeah, I'm thinking like maybe over 5 G's. Yeah, easy. What about you, Jay?
Yeah, total number. The Kemper's a big one, but it's like hands down the best thing you can buy. That's what you're looking for. Just any amp you want, any sound. It's nuts. On top of that, yeah, it's madness.
For sure.
You get lost. You get lost for hours in it.
I'll be there for days working on sounds.
Yeah.
But I think Juan is the most expensive. Oh, Juan, what number are you at? Where are you at, Juan?
Oh, my God. My answer is... I mean, being a drummer, let's just start it off at that, as everything is going to cost you money. Don't act like it's going to be fun playing it. It is fun, but I mean, each cymbal's over $300. The pedals alone are like $800. And, you know, those are DW top notches. And then you have my rolling pads over $800. So, and then on top of the sticks, I fucking keep on breaking the sticks. So... for this month,
I mean,
you
Juan
know,
damn near went through a small,
yeah,
part
like
of
I
the
took down the village by now.
Rainforest,
sorry. Yeah, I mean, it's half my fault, but let's say roughly over, you know, a nice little $10,000, nice little.
You gotta make paper sticks, man. You gotta get paper sticks.
But you know, shout out, help me out.
No more plastic straws, man. Everybody use paper straws, man.
Being a drummer, but
no more plastic fucking straws, man.
My favorite female vocalist.
Ooh, favorite female vocalist. Oh, man, you know, right now I'm torn between saying Stevie Nicks and Janis Joplin. I'm going to pass it to Mena.
It's a tough act to follow.
I like that girl that sings in Evanescence. Amy Lee. Sorry. Amy Lee, shout out to you.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you
rock.
I'm going to mess with the name too, but... the singer from Ginger right now is one of my current favorites.
Yeah, she's brutal, man.
One of my favorites growing up in high school would be Paramore, Hayley Williams. What's up?
I know everybody gets to a certain point in the career where shit gets easy. Are you guys looking forward to the groupies?
I mean... every rock star's dream is a room full of groupies.
Amen.
But we respect, we're looking forward just to going out there and meeting all of our supporters and everybody that really, you know, fucks with the music and fucks with the vibe. And we're all about a good time, man. We want people to have a good time at our shows. We want people, when people come out to our shows now, like our after parties, our crazy orgies with mad drugs and mad alcohol, and people have good times. We're all about good times. Straight up. I mean, you can't get this guy enough fucking party shit. Like,
no.
We're just all about having good times. And I feel like, you know, Concrete Dream is a band about just one giant good time. And and you should be feeling good at our shows. You shouldn't be sad. So we encourage a party, and we encourage everybody to come out and meet each other. And, you know, whether you're, you know, a spouse with a blouse, single, ready to mingle, you up at a Concrete Dream show having a good time, straight up. What did you say? That was well said?
I can't say it any better.
Not.
We support all of our supporters, so everyone gets to love.
It just so happens to be, you know, a lot of girls dig the band.
And I'm okay with that.
We're your girlfriend's favorite band.
Hey.
Shout out.
How you doing?
That's cool. How you doing?